So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome this evening to the Australia-India Institute seminar with Adam De Silva. We're going to enjoy a talk and demonstration of the tantalising culinary delights of India. This, is, as you know, is part of the Health, Culture and Spirituality series. So it's the first year that we've done it. We started the year with meditation. We then had the Indian martial art culinary. And we're going to finish on a fun note and hear about food.
Well, hopefully I am fun. Well, food is fun.
Absolutely. So, Adam, welcome tonight.
Thank you.
We're looking forward to hearing about the fabulous restaurant Tonka, hearing a little bit about the chef behind Tonka and his journey to start a fantastic restaurant that my daughter and I, we had the pleasure last week of heading down to Tonka and having a lovely lunch there. And we got to experience some beautiful delights that really were Indian fusion. As many of you would know, there are so many Indian restaurants around Melbourne, and often when you go to an Indian restaurant, it's almost a bit like the McDonald's experience. You love it, you crave it, you enjoy it whilst you're eating it, but then you feel heavy and awful afterwards. But that wasn't the case with Tonka. It was beautiful, fine, refined food. So, Adam, welcome. We'd love to hear about a little bit about your background and how you started to get into cooking in the first place.
Yeah, well, no worries. Well, thank you. Welcome. I guess what it is, I guess it defines Australia, India / Italy or Italian. As you know, I'm just not, well, I'm an Australian born Italian Indian. So being the first generation of migrants that came over here, I feel like I am a true Australian in the sense that very multicultural, blended in what is now the fabric of, you know, Australian society. We're so multicultural, so many different blends of cultures, and it's reflected through our food, I think, in Australia, and also the hospitality industry, more importantly. And I guess it's, you know, the cultures of Australia actually also reflect the cuisines that we have in Australia these days. You know, so growing up in an Italian and Indian household where, I know this sounds cliche, but I suppose quite, or, you know, back then I actually thought it was quite normal, but having a bowl of pasta on the table and a bowl of curry and rice. So I thought every kid had this as growing up. So, you know, going to a family function, you'd be eating lasagna next to a curry, or, you know, so, and my mother, being Italian, would always make all the curries. So, which, because my father would only eat pasta once a week, so she had to make curries the rest of the day. You know, I'm coming from a butchery family, son of a butcher. We're always surrounded by food and meat more especially. So, you know, there's always a lamb curry or a chicken curry on the table. So, and then going to school also reflected, you know, when I take a chicken schnitzel sandwich or something like, you know, veal schnitzel or prosciutto, like, you know, back 20 years or 30 years ago, it was quite, it was like the typical wog boy, the movie Wog Boy, you know, remember with, you know, with, is it Alec Demetriadis or Vince Colosimo in it. So that was, I guess, me back then. And I guess I didn't really understand who I was or what I was or what kind of, I guess, person, I guess, with the cross cultures that you really are, until now, kind of reflect on it and can appreciate the cross cultures of the combining the cuisine of the cultures of Indian and Italian, which again I think is a beautiful thing, and I'm blessed or fortunate to have that in my life, because it's been able to be a great, enabled me in my cooking career to reflect so many different styles of cooking, but also appreciate all the different cultures. So hence starting with, starting with Tonka. Tonka is an Indian-inspired restaurant. I wouldn't say, like you said, it's not the fast food Indians or the, no offence, but the more, I wouldn't say cheaper, but the more accessible Indian restaurants that are around, mainly in Flinders Street or in the city. And the difference is being, and I think which is a point, there's a couple of differences, is that we don't use ghee in Tonka. Because growing up, my mother never used ghee. She always used extra virgin olive oil when cooking curries, because that's what she used. And so that's what I've now used in all my cooking, you know, whether it be Indian or Asian or, Asian being Chinese or Japanese, in my salad dressings or in my cooking, I use olive oil, which then makes it nice and light and vibrant and fresh. So that was just by coincidence, really. And so then
I guess the olive oil is quite a nice metaphor in a way of your heritage, you know, the olive oil coming from Italy and the Indian food that you use and that you cook, so the two coming together.
Yeah, and it's a great catalyst for cooking in general. You know, back in the day, I think, you know, growing up anyway, more Australian cultured families wouldn't use olive oil. It was unheard of, and now it's pretty much the most used oil probably in the world, next to I guess almost car oil, but then I think still olive oil is the leader, and it's so good for you, and it has many different things. And back in the day also, we were always using Italian olive oils or Spanish olive oils or Greek olive oils, and they're actually now, when you actually taste a really good Australian extra virgin olive oil next to a Greek one, no offence to George Colombaros or anything, because he tries to sell me his olive oil as well. But you're going to support Australian, or support, you know, obviously Australian olive oil is fantastic, and you can taste the total difference of it, especially even with Spanish oil. You know, if it's bitter, it's actually gone, it's rancid. So, you know, you've got to think about it. It spends a month or two on a ship all the way from wherever it does, where we get it from, you know, a few hundred k's away. And it is cheaper, and it's more vibrant, and I guess it's fruitier, not as dense and heavy in flavour, where it doesn't overpower all the food. So does everyone cook with extra virgin olive oil? Yeah, everyone got... does anyone just use the olive oil, normal one? No?
Well, we used to, but then somebody said the boiling point is very low and it actually goes bad when you cook with it.
Well, that's a bit of a, I guess there's two sides to that story, in the sense, you know, if you go to Italy, they use extra virgin olive oil for everything and fry with extra virgin olive oil. So when I cook with schnitzels, especially, I use extra virgin olive oil anything breaded, because all that bread's absorbing all that oil, and you're going to eat all that oil, theoretically. So you want at least a nice, healthy oil that you're going to absorb. And they say it's carcinogenic if you heat it up too much. I don't think you couldn't put extra virgin olive oil in a deep fryer, or you wouldn't like use it in a wok, but you'd use it in more shallow frying, where you're not actually, you know, you don't want to burn the oil as such.
What about coconut oil, Adam? These days, coconut oil it's been used for hundreds and thousands of years in Kerala, and then it sort of went out with all the cholesterol rage, but now it's sort of made a huge comeback.
Yeah, well, it's interesting you're saying that, because that now has a personal effect on me as well, because now I've apparently got high cholesterol. And that's not from eating ghee, I think it's from eating too much salami. and saturated fats, as opposed to, like, you know, the chicken skin and stuff like that. So, there's people saying that coconut milk is also good for you, or coconut cream is good for you. Look, I think everything in moderation, you know.
Scientists change their minds every day.
Correct. I'm not against coconut oil. I just think I prefer a more lighter, an oil that doesn't carry too many flavour, doesn't overpower anything that I'm cooking with. That's a good, you know, catalyst for all the dishes, whether it's being cooking, like heating it up, or in a salad. But people are using coconut oil for everything. Apparently, for your hair, for your skin. The previous bachelor, I can tell you another story. He said he uses it for everything, and I went, everything, and he goes, everything. So apparently, he's got it in his bathroom, his kitchen, his hair, wherever. So
the rest we don't want to know.
The rest you don't want to know about. But in that Tim Robards guy. So obviously works for him, because he's looking pretty good. But anyway, we'll move on.
So from a young age, you were sort of primed towards cooking and food. Can you tell us a little bit more about how you got more into that in your adolescence, and then how you ended up in the cooking field altogether?
Well, I ended up, obviously being the son of a butcher, and I had uncles and they were in the wine industry. And then also growing up, being brought up by my nonna and nonno, they had chickens, and they'd grow grapes and make their own salami, and would make tomatoes every year. So I guess being surrounded by it, and then being also, you know, obviously being babysat by them, you know, as young boys, you kind of get fidgety, and they would always make us, you know, turn the wheel of the pasta machine or help knead the gnocchi and dough. So gnocchi was actually one of the first dishes I ever made. So that's one of my kind of sentimental favourite dishes is a good gnocchi. And people ask me, what's a good recipe? It's all by touch. Just like with all food, it's about feel and having that, repetitive nature about it, where you get used to it and you get this. With cooking, you got to cook with your eyes, smell, your ears, your hands. There's so many. Use all your senses in cooking, and that's what makes, I guess, cooking so passionate. Also, why chefs are so passionate, there's a certain love for cooking that, as a young kid, I just loved cooking, but then as you turn to a professional side. It actually is a really hard job, and I want to wish it on anyone, because you think about it, you're standing all day for 16 hours in a hot environment, stressful environment, you've got a lot of things happening on, there's so many variables, there's other sides to it where you're not busy, you're waiting for the customer to come in, sometimes there's too many customers, so trying to get the food out, then you have angry customers are going, where's my food, because as soon as you walk into the restaurant, you think you're the only person out of 70 that needs to be fed. So I think there's a different love, there's a passion and a love. Fortunately, I kind of like both of them, but I actually didn't realise, so going through my whole career, I started cooking at home. So I used to come home from primary school because my parents were still working, so I'd always have to make something to eat, let myself in, go make get a bowl of, some spaghetti, make a bowl of pasta. And then my brother was actually a better cook than I was, but he went into the more creative kind of advertising world, a bit smarter than me in by grades, he was actually a really good cook. So I started making pizzas and being a kitchen hand when I was 16 and 17. So then I used to make cook pizzas 3 nights a week in Templestowe, a little pizza shop, during year 12. So I used to do that Friday, Saturday and Sunday nights, 5 hours a night. And then I used to go out afterwards with my friends and socialise, and I used to go to school on Monday and fall asleep. That was my way of my mum identifying, I guess, my passion and love for cooking, that it was beyond just, making gnocchi or a pasta. So I thank her for that, and I wouldn't be in that, I guess, look back and go, I wouldn't be in this position now if she didn't kind of steer me in the right direction of that. So, and then started my apprenticeship 20 years ago to this year, actually. So I feel like I've been cooking more than half my life. So it's actually a really, there's different now, 20 years on later, there's different things I look into cooking and what cooking's given me. It's not only being fortunate to be able to open my own businesses, but more importantly, being able to travel the world cooking and experience different cultures. As I was just saying before, I was in a few years ago, I was cooking along the Mekong River in a boat from Saigon to Angkor Wat. And I was saying that was probably the strangest kitchen I ever cooked in, because I was in like the third level of this like big kind of fairy looking boat that had 25 suites on it. And it was interesting, you can send a menu down and ingredient and recipes, but then until you get onto the boat and you kind of see what happens, you kind of go, why is everything in the freezer for? Because I'm in Vietnam and they can't get fresh, some fresh things, and you go to the market. So it's an amazing experience. And then being fortunate to cook in New York. So I've cooked in New York for a few months for Thomas Keller. I cooked in Hong Kong. I've cooked in, just came back from cooking in Tasmania. I cooked in Singapore this year. Like all the beautiful countries of the world, and being able to experience in that is, going to India at the end of October to cook again. So for the Australian World Orchestra, which would be, I guess, a highlight of my career. I think that'd be a really great thing to do in Chennai. So, I guess what I'm saying is that cooking is such a beautiful transient profession also, and it's an international language. So you don't have to be of any intelligence, you don't have to be of any nationality or age, that it's just cooking, just when you go, I can walk into any kitchen in the world and you communicate through food, because a lot of the kitchens I've cooked in, especially in places, like Vietnam or Cambodia, is that we can't communicate through language, we actually communicate through actions and through the food. So,
and when we talk about Indian food, India is such a heterogeneous country with multiple influences from different countries, the Mughal Empire, Christian, Portuguese, yeah. So many different influences make Indian food sort of a melting pot. How do you draw from different parts of India, and now how do you define Indian food, and so what led to the inspiration of starting Tonka?
I think what led to how I define Indian food, I guess I would like to say that I'm kind of redefining Indian food in Australia, because I know that what I'm doing at Tonka, or what we're doing at Tonka, not just me, a team of people, more importantly, because in a restaurant, there's just not just one head chef. You need everyone else to help come together. You know, we kind of just steer the ship. But, you know, the most important person in the kitchen is actually the kitchen hand, believe it or not. Because without a kitchen hand or a kitchen porter, the kitchen doesn't go. You know, our chefs can cook, all that, it's great, but that needs to keep on coming. And they're the people that you, like, respect the most. You know, you get a lot of chefs out there that don't respect them. But anyway, that's a side. So that's a sidetrack from it. But I like to think that not only do the peers and colleagues say it, but the pioneering Indian, in the sense that taking the flavours of India, the spices, and transforming that into what we have in Australia. You know, in Australia, also trying to define. I think you could call it Australian Indian, but I don't like to call it modern Indian as such. Even though it is modern, we are modernising it. I'm not to say I don't want to. You know, I guess what I was saying. A comparison is you've got these great chefs of India like the Manish Mahotra or the Kunal Kapoor, and they are like the Paul Bocuse's of Indian cuisine, where they trick the food up a lot, you know, and take it away from the traditional, I guess, home style cooking. Where I like to think that my difference is that I've got a fantastic backyard, which is Australia, with the most amazing ingredients, the freshest ingredients, you know, like the Hiramatsu kingfish I'm going to use today, the lamb from Gippsland, you know, all these beautiful, like, you know, salmon and ocean trout from Tasmania, these corn-fed chickens, the beef, even that is against, like, obviously, you know, we're in Australia and that appeals to the market. So, you know, the pork and the seafood that we have abundance, and also our fruit and vegetables, is what helped define my restaurant and makes it different to what anyone else is really doing also, you know, because without great produce at the end of the day, you can't have a great product, or, you know, without great bones. So I like to think that, you know, no one was ever doing, you know, we joked about it, actually, my business partner Zai, about 4 years ago. And after we did Coda, because obviously I opened Coda, which is now defined more as a modern Asian restaurant. We kind of marketed it as French Vietnamese when we first opened 6.5 years ago, because we needed, like, you know, as everyone needs, you need some sort of concept. You need to catch everyone's imagination, or the you know, you need a selling point.
A niche, a selling point,
you know. So that's kind of transformed into more Asian European. So we actually joked about opening an Indian restaurant, but no one was really doing it at the level that we are, where you get. Like, it's going, like, if you ever, has anyone been to Tonka, going to a normal restaurant, which is quite high level, fine dining style restaurant, but eating Indian flavoured food, because, you know, and then drinking great wine, with great produce and great service. So I think, you know, people have done it for Middle Eastern food, the Greg Maloofs of the world. Did it, if anyone knows Greg Maloof, or the Shane Dalias of the world, but no one really done it for Indian food. So I think it's, you know. And, you know, India is such a great, big, beautiful country that why not, you know, use all that and, you know, use it in Australia as well. And also, you know, obviously the population and the diversity in Australia is growing with Indian population.
So it's been very well received and awarded.
It's been very well received. It's been very well received, and it was actually a hard sell, believe it or not. And that sounds like, probably saying, feel like I'm giving you too much about what happens back of house in the restaurant world. But when we first opened Tonka, and mind you, the reason why we called Tonka, it's not because I liked Tonka trucks when I was growing up. It was, there was a nightclub, if you're around my age, so if you're around 25, no. I went out and there was a nightclub called Honky Tonks. So if anyone's, you know, late 30s, early 40s, and we used to go out. So we'd kind of just use that as a, you know, Honky Tonks, Tonka, just wanted to have some sort of correlation to it. And we always just want to have one word, two syllables, same with Coda. That way people remember it. You know, like Coda's named after a Led Zeppelin album. Does anyone follow, listen to Led Zeppelin? No? Yeah, so there's an album called Coda. But actually what I said to the, what I would say to the media when we open Coda, because Coda is Coda. Coda is like tail in Italian, which is a tail that gives the end of music, like, you know, the finish of end of, finishing and the end of music, is, gives a balance and harmony, the Coda. So that was my kind of like spiel to the to all the food critics, are, you know, my food's balanced and harmonious and all this kind of stuff. Which sounded great at the time, then I was like, no, it's actually named after Led Zeppelin, that one. Anyway, a name's a name, and you create an identity with the name. So no matter what I called it, it's like, I use a perfect example of Andrew McConnell, who has Cumulus and Cumulus Up and Supernormal. It's like, who names a restaurant after a cloud? Doesn't make sense, does it? But you identify that brand with it, and as long as you have that product as well. So anyway, getting back to the hard sell of Tonka, when people ring up and we try to get people to go to Tonka, because when we just opened, and we say it was Indian, majority of people would go, oh no, I don't want to eat Indian. No. Especially the women were like, you know, because the men, this would always like, men will always go and have the Indian on their Monday nights with their mates or whatever, or their Wednesday nights with their mates to an extent. Be like, oh no, because it's like heavy and stodgy and full of ghee. But finally, still, you know, it's just now 2.5 years later that, this, you know, there's no hard sell about it. It's kind of like everyone caught on after the first few months, and I think people are really quite surprised when they do come and dine at Tonka finally to realise it's not Indian. As a, I've upset some traditionalists when they've come in, and they go, "I'm not going to spend $15 on a biryani." It's like, well, you're not just spending $15 on a bowl of, you know, biryani or a dal, or, you know, $8 for a dal. It's like, you got to think about where you're eating it, you know? You're sitting on really expensive chairs that cost probably $1,000 each. A sommelier you're paying, you know, $30 an hour to, in beautiful regal glasses, drinking a really nice wine, and you got a team, you know, it's like the whole, you're paying for the experience.
The whole experience, and you can't please everyone.
Correct. So, you know, and that's the whole thing about restaurants, you know, you're not always going to make everyone happy.
That's right.
And, you know, you got to have a thick skin in the game, and especially these days with this whole social media and urban spoon, I know Zomato now it's called or something like that, and what's the other one called? TripAdvisor. And every person that comes in now is a blogger, believe it or not. True story. You just can't. Just spread good. If you've got nothing good to say, don't say anything at all. You know, because it's like I come into your workplace and I come and go, mate, you're not doing a good job there. It's like, and post it. It's like, well, what's the relevant? You're going to say, it's kind of like, you know, that's another topic altogether. But anyway, but social media is a very powerful tool, and it uses, you know, people out there think they're a food critic all of a sudden and give an uneducated opinion. Not that I've got anything against bloggers or anything like that. I just choose not to. I just don't read it really. Otherwise, you go insane, I think, if you, you know, by all people's criticisms or. But then people have got good things to say as well.
Adam, I'm starting to get hungry, mate.
I know, you better start cooking.
Anyone else hungry here?
So first in best dressed, I guess.
So we're now going to move to the kitchen. So Adam, talk us through it. What are we going to do today?
So I'm going to do four dishes from Tonka, which are on the menu. Some are a stalwart of Tonka. So has anyone eaten the lamb curry at Tonka? Yeah, no? You'll probably hopefully eat it afterwards, after this. That's right. Well, you might eat it after this, literally, and we might come to Tonka afterwards. So I guess one of the first dishes I'm doing is a gin-cured kingfish. And look, you could say it's fusion. I always like to say that my cooking isn't fusion as such. I think it's because sometimes it can be confusion. I think, you know, they get young chefs out there that want to add balsamic and soy together. But I think what it is I like to keep each culture honest to a certain degree, or true to where it comes from and where it exists. You know, like all these foams and gels, they have a place in cooking. I don't think they all should be on every dish, you know. When you go to a restaurant, I think they should be used sparingly. And that I think that, you know, beautiful cuisines like the Indian cuisine, Chinese, Italian, Japanese have existed for so many hundreds of years for a reason, you know. Doing a foam and all that isn't going to really last, or a gel, as proven in the world today, you know, the albulis and all that. So anyway, what I'm going to do is I've got some kingfish here, which is beautiful here at Muscle Kingfish, which comes from South Australia. So a farmed fish, because the majority of fish now in Australia is all farmed. Did you know that? Unless you're buying like a snapper. Unless you're buying like a snapper or a flathead or a John Dory, they're all pretty much farmed. Sorry?
Pike.
Pike, yep. Thank you, pike. Anchovies, yep.
Shark.
Shark, thank you. Banjo shark, gummy shark, calamari. There's, sorry? What's the other one?
Whales.
We're going to steer clear of whales. I had the opportunity to try whale when I was in Japan about 10 years ago as sushi, and it looked like it looked like eye fillet on rice. But that wasn't a pleasurable experience. So what we did was we've done a cure using some coriander, some lime, some sugar and salt. So pretty much what it does is just draws all the moisture out of it. Do you want to try to slice this? You're good at slicing? You're right? You don't have a problem cutting fish?
Maybe.
You have a problem? No? Yeah, no?
No, I don't.
You have a problem?
No.
Okay, you can do that then. That was confusing. Okay. do you want to come and slice? I'll show you one. You can slice it. Just like nice thin slices like that. Oh, actually, maybe we might go a bit more creative. How about we get a bit creative and we can do like, is that easier for you like that? Thin, long, thin slices like that. You can do that. I'm not going to do it all for you. It's all right. Nice.
What are our volunteers' names, Adam?
Samika?
Prag.
I didn't mean to meet you earlier.
Natali.
Natali. Welcome.
So, come across this side. So what we're going to do is part of the dish has some tempered yogurt, which tempering is, the imparting flavour and toasting of spices. So when you make a curry beforehand, you would temper your spices like your coriander, your cumin, your cardamom, your mustard seeds, which we do quite a bit with all our curries at Tonka. And there's probably some people in the audience going, I know how to cook already, but this is like a something, I know, there's a over there. Looking at me like, yes, yeah, I know what you're talking about. But I guess, you got good, have you been on MasterChef or something? Can you apply?
Just in my office.
Just in your office? Do you do this in your office?
Just cook for the team.
Oh, you cook for your team? You cook for your office?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Just desserts?
Yeah. Oh, you bring like cakes every day?
Nutella cheesecake.
Cheesecake?
Nutella.
Cheesecake. Nutella's cheesecake?
Yeah, Nutella.
Really? What's the ratio of Nutella to cheese?
There's more cheese than Nutella.
Right.
A bit of cream as well.
Is it like one spoon of Nutella for you and then another spoon for the cheesecake?
No, it's just...
Oh, it's like a swirl.
4 tablespoons for 500 grams of cheese.
Yeah, right.
That's it.
Cool. Baked or raw?
Raw.
Oh, it's interesting. That's right. You learn something new every day, see? I'm going to go back to town and tell my pastry chef again, I want a Nutella cheesecake on the menu. To go with a Toblerone cocktail. So, you're pretty good. You're nifty. Watch your thumb, though. There's no insurance here. We're cover. So, just going to heat some oil up. Going to add some... Hey?
I hope I don't ruin it.
Some mustard seed, you don't ruin it. No, you're not ruining it, you're doing a good job. You're doing a better job than some of my apprentices would do. You want a job?
Yeah.
Don't pay that much though. I can pay you in Nutella. So just tempering the mustard seeds here. And then I've got some asafoetida, which is a flavouring compound. It's like garlic. Has it like a beautiful? It's like the I call it like the little Malcolm X of cooking, because it's just that little unknown little thing that just makes everything taste good. So then we would mix some of the yogurt into that. Ooh. You must be hungry. Good thing you did your nails today. Looks good. And this forms a base of our dish. So we've got some yogurt here. And what we do is to make it look all nice and fancy. we'd spread it all on the plate like that. And the reason why we use a yogurt also is it's got a nice, beautiful, you know, acidic nature to it, creamy, which goes well with the fish, which is quite salty and sweet. So it's all about contrast as well. You know, with all cooking, you know, contrast is the biggest kind of principle in cooking, I think. You always want things that taste kind of sweet and salty or hot and sour. You know, traditional thing is like that hot, you know, ice cream, hot ice cream, no, cold ice, can't even know, hot ice cream. Cold ice cream on something hot is like, you know, the contrast. But that would make sense what I'm saying. So then we can just like arrange all this. So you can cure salmon, ocean trout, you can cure fish yourself as long as it's nice and fresh. Because fresh is best, really. You can like arrange it like that. So it's a great, has anyone cured fish, their own fish before? No? It's quite simple. As long as it's actually quite easy, you know, just with sugar and salt mix. Then we have some rainbow beets, which have been shaved nice and thin and raw. So just for texture. Cure. For about 6 hours. Because otherwise it keeps on, just like when you make anything, like with like prosciutto, when you're curing a ham, you're drawing the moisture out, you're actually cooking it. But the sweet, you need the sugar in it to make it nice, but to balance it out. Otherwise it tastes salty. And you can do it with beef as well. Or
happy for people to ask Adam questions during the demonstration.
Yeah, feel free to ask.
Open floor.
Don't be shy. You can ask for the Nutella cheesecake recipe if you want. I know, I will be afterwards. Some asparagus we've shaved nice and raw. And at the end of the day, like, you know, the raw food movement, you know, I think it's nice to have some sort of raw vegetable, you know, but not a big plate of raw vegetables. So what we have here is some samosa dough, which we've rolled out and fried. So deconstructing or adding a texture to it rather than, you know, doing your traditional samosa. And I guess this keeps it nice and fresh. You know, you want something, when you're eating something cured like a salmon or a smoked salmon, you want something like a bread to eat it with. And then we've got some beautiful little nasturtions that we've foraged. Don't know, we just ordered them in actually, but it sounded good. Foraging, you know, all the rage today. Does anyone go to forage? Has anyone got a garden out the back of their house and they can forage for their herbs and stuff? Around the street? Do you forage around the street? What do you get around the street? Do you go steal roses from other people's front yards?
Beautiful orange one this morning.
Really? Do you steal lemons from people's houses as well?
Yeah.
Very expensive lemons these days and limes.
Adam, the presentation part of it is quite an art form.
You can put, yeah, well, it is. Well, art. Well, at the end of the day, you eat with your eyes. No matter how, as I'll show you with my lamb dish, the lamb curry doesn't look that great, but it actually really tastes really good. So naturally, you eat with you always. It's like, you know, they never, like they say, don't judge a book by its cover. You always judge a person by what they're wearing to an extent, but you'll always judge what a plate of food looks like. Because you always, like, I already look at, and I'm at fault as well. Like, I'll, you know, go to somewhere and I'll look at a plate of food and I'll be like, I'll make a decision by just purely by seeing it. But maybe I see different things in it as well. You know, I can kind of probably gauge how old it is. And I have kind of phobias with old food that I don't eat leftovers the next day because I just don't know, just can't do it. That's what makes me, I guess, an OCD chef, as most chefs are OCD or fussy in some way. So here you go. Just put a little drizzle of extra virgin olive oil on top just to bring it all together because everything tastes good with olive oil on it. And there you go, a cured kingfish with some tempered yogurt, some samosa. So there you go, you can hold it like that. There you go, champion. Right, put it down, it's sort of pretty, isn't it? So the next thing I'm going to do is a scallop dish. which has a fennel puree and a Madras spice mixture. So, excuse my my makeshift kitchen here. So they're quite handy. And if anyone likes these pans, they're Anolon pans. So I have to give a free plug because they're really good to use. No, no one has Anolon pans. Has anyone got Anolon pans? Do you like them? Yep. Cool. You can go online. You can see I've got recipes where I use different. Don't worry about it. Obviously, everyone's like Bessemer or something else. No, can't make yourself buy Anolon pans. Okay, I have to give it a go.
How important is a pan, Adam?
A pan is very important. So whether they're commercial ones like this, a heavy base pan is what helps cook through properly or retain heat when you're cooking. And I guess the biggest, fault that amateur cooks do and apprentices do is that they don't heat their pan up when cooking. You know, so especially when you're wok cooking, you got to heat the pan up. So when you're putting something cold or raw into a pan, you're absorbing all the heat out of the pan. So if it's not hot enough, obviously it's not going to cook and sear and it can stew. So what we have here is some scallops here. So we've got a spice mixture made up with salt, cumin, cardamom, some fenugreek. So we just coat the scallops in this spice mix. So, you know, in all cooking, I guess what this is really saying is that all cooking doesn't have to be long and slow and braised and heavy, where, you know, you can use seafood and use lots of spices and dry. You would call this, you know, I guess in French terms, a dry rub, you know, rather than a wet marinade. So,
Adam, what's your favourite homey Indian dish?
I'd have to say biryani. Cause it's all like a one pot. Like for me, it's like a one pot wonder. Like, cause I'm kind of lazy when I cook at home. I like to just do, and it's just I like get everything and get the rice, and it's just really flavor like, and the you know, chicken. So that's my favourite chicken. Good chicken biryani.
And your favourite sweet?
My favourite sweet. Oh, Nutella cheesecake. look, I think one of my favourite sweet. I do like a gulab, but they're rich. I'd have to say that sweet things, I tend to go for more French things. So as Tonka and Coda is, I would use French techniques using Indian flavours. So like whether it be parfaits or ice creams, I think that they're just a lot more. You know, I think the sugar hit, the sweetness of it as well. So, you know, at home I like to make a lemon delicious pudding. I know that sounds really silly, but I like to make a lemon delicious pudding because I like the custard to it. But in both restaurants, even though they're of, you know, Asian background, we always use French techniques for desserts, I think, because you've got a greater spectrum. I'm not going to turn the smoke alarm
I can
off.
See some of you are worried about the smoke alarms, no. But they have been turned off.
Do you want to do this? You can do this. Sorry. Where's my other volume? Oh, there you are. Okay, there you go.
You
can keep turning it. So what we can do is we can kind of like, you can, we say nappe or, you know, pour the oil over the scallop like that.
Yep.
That makes it nice and
So, did you use any kind of flour in this?
No flour, just straight spice. Yeah. Okay. You can pass it around. And cinnamon, you can pass it around if you like to smell it. Yeah, great job.
So, Adam, I know there's a few apprentice chefs and up-and-coming chefs in the audience here tonight.
Are they?
What are some of the qualities that you look for when you're selecting a team?
That's a good question. So, qualities, I guess, I look for in a chef when coming to a kitchen is, I guess, attitude. Attitude is the greatest, I guess, thing I look for, because if they don't want to be there, then there's no point there's no point being there. And I guess in a kitchen, it's very close. You work close with people, and they've got to fit into the dynamic. You know, I couldn't say that I could go work at Attica or Vieux-Nomon because I probably wouldn't fit into the dynamic of that kitchen, you know, even though I can cook, but they can cook differently. So one thing I also look at is whether they fit into the team. They like the team and the team likes them, because that's probably ready now. So what I have here, I've had some fennel which I've cooked in a bit of cream and some onion and garlic, just some, and then we just, oh, you can place it. No, that's all right, you won't ever cook it, it's okay. You can place it. As we do in the kitchen, you know, people think that food just magically appears on plates. But actually, you got to use your hands a bit. So you can just leave it there, unreal.
So do you think shows like MasterChef make the food industry a little bit more glamorous than what it is?
I don't think they glamorise it. That's a good question, because I was actually going to say, I don't, like, My Kitchen Rules and MasterChef don't glamorise being a chef as much as you say. I think being like this whole celebrity chef craze or trend or whatever it is, or movement. I think it actually, the thing I love about places like shows like MasterChef and My Kitchen Rules and all that is that it actually educates the general public about how hard it is to be a chef, and the pressures, as you know now, the pressure of having, even though it's a bit different, but the pressure of making food on a certain time limit and doing multiple dishes of it. Yeah, I think hopefully it gives everyone else a bit more of an understanding of what it is like to be in a commercial kitchen. So I think it's great. It's been great for our industry. You know, I think hopefully it makes more people want to come into be a chef. As I said, you know, do it if you really love it. You know, I don't, like, there's so many things you can do with it. You know, as you can see, there's so many, you know, especially being in Australia also. I think Australia is on world stage with our food, with our restaurants. You know, even having cooked around the world, you know, I think that have a phenomenal level and standard, and our produce is second to none. So I think it's, you know, the more people that know about cooking, the more people that see about cooking, the more we talk about cooking, It's great, you know, because at the end of the day, it's a bit of a dying trade, because, you know, people do watch MasterChef and go, okay, and I've had some of those contestants, you know, runners up and all that, come into the restaurant and do some time, and they struggle, I think, with the fame and actually just wanting to be a chef, you know, because people come in and go, oh, you know, such and such is there, but they all, you know, there's a stigma from other chefs, all the other chefs in the kitchen that go, oh, you know, they feel inadequate because they've been on the show, but they've been glorified, but don't have the skill to actually just do it day to day in a normal commercial kitchen. So, you know, and I think, I don't know whether it gives them a false sense of reality also about it all, you know, thinking that they come from a show where it's been also articulated, than to go out into the real world. And that's why I say to all those contestants, like, make sure you really want to do this. You know, it's great you've done the show and you've achieved it, and what you've done is amazing, because it's not easy to get to that level in the show, but you got to really love it. You got to really want to have some sort of plan to do it, you know, not just, you know, and everyone changes cooking. I've had lots of mature age students come to cooking after being, you know, in law or an accountant, or they want a tree change. And it's like, it's a hard slog, because they're not going to earn the money they do, because it's a very underpaid, it's an underpaid industry, you know. Our wages don't go up, you know, they pretty much stay the same over the years. So, and it's really hard. It's hard to make money. And then, you know, as I said, a bad review can close a business. So, you know, that's why sometimes, so you think that, you know, an opinion doesn't matter much on social media, it could actually close a business and affects people's lives. So that's a harsh reality of it, because, you know, very fortunate to be in that top 1% or 5% of the industry where you can be positively geared. You know, a lot of the industry standard work at, you know, normally at negative 1%. So they run at a loss, believe it or not, because no matter what, how many, if I did all this food tonight and then I only get 10 people through the door or 100 people through the door, I've still spent all the money on the food, I've still got to have all the same labour on it. So the cost of goods is the hardest part and challenges in a restaurant, but not only with that, consistency. Consistency is the rest, like I remember Gordon, one good thing Gordon Ramsay had said, which I remember, is that consistency is the hardest thing in a restaurant, because even though you might just go to one restaurant once a month, you remember, not the chefs, but you remember how that dish tastes like and how it should taste like. So when people say, when regular customers come in and go, I had the chicken or the duck curry and it's like, that didn't taste the same. It's like, cool, thanks. Then really know that didn't taste it. You know, that's because the memory of what it tastes like is second to none. So that's the hardest thing for restaurants also. And also the consistency is harder because you always got different people doing the same job. So anyway, we've got some pear which has been pickled in verjuice. Does everyone know verjuice? Verjuice is grapes before it's been fermented. You got the food is there. Yep. And verjuice. Maggie beer verjuice. So adding fruit to a dish, I guess, gives it a nice tartness. And, you know, fruit is one of the understated things to cook with. You don't always have to cook with vegetables because it gives it different characters for the dish. So these have been just pickled in vinegar and sugar also, the little onions. And then it's dyed a bit, maybe because of the bright lights. So, freshen up.
You mentioned about social media.
Yes.
What about, how much do you engage with your customers if they give you feedback?
At the restaurant, because...
Oh, we respond straight away, definitely. And then I would also, if it's negative, I'll actually call them myself.
Okay.
Because it's like, well, I just want to know, well, like, you know, I'm... have that connection with them and go, what didn't you like? You know, well, how can we rectify it? Welcome them back to the restaurant if we can. And surprisingly enough, I would say 8 out of 10 people do not, if I miss them, they don't call me back. Because I think it's that, you know, I leave a message and then they're just kind of like, then I've reached out to them, but then they just don't want the confrontation. They just feel in. I don't know, they're just saying, well, not confrontation, because I'm not confronting them. I'm actually just like reaching out and wanting to have a conversation and you know, because at the end of the day, you know, I want you to come back to the restaurant. I don't know, for me, it's an unhappy customer where I'll lose business from them, but also lose business from 10 other of their friends. So as what happens in hospitality, or maybe it happens in all industries, but, you know, word of mouth, you know, you have one good experience, you tell 2 people, you have one bad experience, and you tell 10 people. So, anyway, I think this is kind of a bit limp, but we'll look at it anyway like that. So,
do you have a lot of people that come and say, I want to meet the chef and say hello to them and talk to them about how I felt? Or is it mostly critics that do that?
No, I think what...
How much do you entertain that?
I'll talk to any customer that comes in, and sometimes customers don't want to be disturbed. They don't want me to... go and say, how are you going? You know, or then some people might get upset because I'm talking to someone that I may know or they wanted to talk to me and they go, oh, well, the chef. So it's a very hard, fine line, you know, to respect people's privacy when they're dining also, you know. But everyone thinks that, you know, I'm there every night at Tonka and a Coda cooking the meal, where it's like, you know, you can't be 2 places at once and you can't be there every night. Hence why it comes down to the team, you know. You know, it's like Valentina doesn't sew all these buttons kind of analogy. So you can't always be there. And one thing also, Gordon, I keep banging on about Gordon Ramsay, but one thing he said that the same people cook when I'm there and the same people cook when I'm not there. Because when you have a kitchen big enough, like a Coda and Tonka, or especially Tonka, we've got like 9 chefs in the kitchen. So I'm not there, you know, I plate some food up, but they're all the kitchens that it's separated into different sections. So you've got, you know, a fryer section, which does a lot of the, obviously does all the deep frying of food and pecoras and stuff like that. You've got a larder section, which does all, you know, two people on that. You've got someone on the tandoor ovens, and you've got someone on the curry section. You know, have someone on the grill section, just grilling meats and seafood. Then we're fortunate enough to have a pastry section. So you've got a pastry chef there, and then you have someone on the pass, organising all the food to send out to the tables. So, you know, that's the big, what I think I would do most is actually coordinating the kitchen. So it comes down to kitchen management, yes, but then people do get disappointed. And it is, it's called hospitality for a reason. You need to be there. You've got to try and be there as much as possible. But also you need to, you know, I guess have a life and do other things outside it. And, you know, if you do travel, you can't be there all the time. But hopefully the product is the same, and that when you come in, you get the same greeting and level of food and level of service. So there's so many different, factors and to take into consideration when running a restaurant. Everyone thinks it's pretty easy. You can just open up a kitchen and, you know, serve some food.
Hi. Could you just tell us again what's in that fennel mix? It looks like yogurt from back here, but you said...
Oh, no, it's fennel. Just like pureed fennel with cream. Yep. It put in a thermomix. So just onion, garlic, fennel and some cream. Just basic, and then we put in a thermomix. We actually don't cook it in the thermomix. We cook it in a pot and then put in the thermomix. Does anyone have a thermomix here? No, talking to the wrong crowd? Okay.
You have a
Nutribullet. Probably cheaper, isn't it? Or just... Yeah, same thing, just except thermomixers cook and do risotto and all that kind of stuff.
Got a question up the back there?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah, anyway.
Adam, I wanted to know who's your favourite Indian chef, and is there a particular technique that you follow in your dishes?
I wouldn't say follow. I like Manish Mahotra would be my favourite chef. But I don't want to say follow any techniques. I think it's more how the flavours they use and what they do. I think because there's more than just one technique. I think to say techniques is kind of like there's so many techniques in one dish or just in cooking in general. So what I also like to say, I think, is that the techniques that I do use in the food are just things that I've gathered and learned along the way. And what I say to all my young chefs is that you've got 9 chefs in the kitchen. Everyone's doing the same. Everyone can do the same. Everyone has to do the same job at some stage. Choose the best way that you think you want to do it and adapt it to that way. You know, you learn your own style and your own technique. You know, to mirror someone identical is kind of boring. I think you got to create, and that's when chefs create their own style, through being creative and by learning different techniques and being exposed to all different chefs. So, for example, if I walked into a kitchen around the corner tonight, I would learn a technique already, a different technique. That's what I love walking into foreign kitchens, because you don't get it in your own kitchen that often. But when I do cook in other people's kitchens and hotels, that I can learn half a dozen different techniques of how they store their fish or how they cut their meat or cook it, or what they do to it. So I think it's, you know, that's what I love about cooking. You're always learning, you know. Even though I've been doing it for 20 years, I feel like I still don't know a lot, you know. It's always challenging and interesting. And then when you get to a different level in your career where now you also worry more about the business side of things, you know, how you're going to pay the bills and, you know, taking that risk and doing that becomes different also. I think you've got to try and wear many hats. You know, there's a lot of great chefs out there who are great artists. There's the artists, the chefs are the artists, and then there's a chef that's the businessman, you know, to make, you know, because you can look at all these great chefs and their businesses fail because they don't know how to count the dollars and make it work at the end of the day. So it's a juggling act.
Adam, how long would you spend in a week or whatever in practicing on creating something new?
I wouldn't say practice, but I guess it's collaboration. So you can kind of, I can go away overseas or something, I'll go out and I'll be like, cool, let's come back and try that dish. So, or you adapt it from another dish you've done, you know, the DNA of one dish which you have a formula kind of in your own head how some kind of chefs have some sort of repetitive nature about it. So, you know, you can spend a few hours a week but it can be just over a glass of wine. Oh, so let's do this. And because now also for cooking for so long, if you gave me a pile of ingredients, I could visually already create a dish and kind of know what it tastes like already, because you work with that product and those flavours so often that you just kind of can already bring it together in your head, you know, like you already painted the picture. But then you trial it and you go, okay, cool, maybe we do that instead. And then you'll eat it. Because, you know, at the end of the day, you want it to make it look pretty, but then also you kind of like want it to taste good, you know. So, and then not overcomplicating a dish. You know, I think the hardest thing for young cooks these days is having restrain in their cooking. And that's why I said about fusion and confusion is about, you know, I think the great chefs in the world just can make two or three ingredients really good on a plate, but just having that discipline to actually go, okay, that's what I'm going to do, and using really great produce, and the technique, then coming back to technique, it's a technique of the execution. You know, like I think for Italian food, and that's what I think, you know, I love having best of both worlds, is that, you know, simple rustic Italian food is the hardest, one of the hardest cuisines to do, because it's all about the technique. You know, to cook a pasta perfectly, you know, or bake a piece of fish, they're the hardest. You know, same with French, you know, normal rustic French cooking. Cooking that piece of, you know, fish fillet or piece of steak perfectly is one technique, but to perfect it is the hardest thing to do, you know. So I think, and I think, you know, yeah, it's an amazing, it's over, I don't like overcomplicated food. That's why, you know, like, you know, I appreciate all the you know, Attica's and whatever, you know, of the world, not just pinpointing Attica in general, but just in that type of level of cooking. I appreciate those, but they don't nourish me. They don't feed me. They don't make me feel good about, you know, they don't make me feel good or satisfied. You know, where the food I like to cook is it's nourishing. It's different. It's creative. There's a variety. Because you think about it. I think about like the people that, you know, diners. There are some diners in the world or in Melbourne that come to me, go to Tonka on a Monday night. They go to Cumulus on a Tuesday night. They'll go to the European on a Wednesday night. They'll go to Movida on a Thursday night, and that is their week. They dine out constantly. There are people out there. So this global financial crisis doesn't mean anything. Because when we opened Coda in a global financial crisis back in 2008, right in the thick of it, and we were full. So the only difference is that the stockbrokers go out and order the $80 bottle of wine, not the $180 bottle of wine. But anyway, that's just another observation of the restaurant world.
You got two more dishes, Adam?
Two more dishes, quickly.
talk and cook, questions.
Talk and cook.
Adam, you talk about the importance of consistency.
Yes.
How do you manage to juggle consistency for the customer as well as encourage creativity amongst your chefs?
That's a good question. Well, for the consistency is, well, it's a team effort, and I guess our floor staff, our front of house staff are fantastic, my business partners, where there's quality control all along the way. So it goes from them to whoever's on the pass, whether it be me. And I can already go kind of like, okay, you're burning that, or that's not going to work, or, you know, do it again. And then I'll have waiters that would refuse to take the food to the table, because they look at it and go, if it's a younger, they're getting it off a younger chef or something like that. But if it's bypassed whoever's doing it. On the senior kitchen member, they'll go, I'm not taking that. They'll go, what do you mean? Well, that's not how it's supposed to look. So there's lots of barriers to get before it gets to the customer. Sometimes there are it does get through the keeper sometimes. I'm not saying we're not perfect in the restaurant world, and that's why, you know, there's a certain percent that not everyone's going to like it, or not everyone's going to have the most perfect dining experience. And the funny thing is, and believe it or not, people that tend to have the perfect dining experience, I know a lot of people do in general, but without fail, people in the hospitality industry, I think, will tend to get a far more consistent dining experience than people that aren't recognised within the industry. I know this sounds really silly, but for example, when I do go to dine in restaurants, because I probably do know them, that, I mean, if you ask me about a certain restaurant, I say, oh, what do you think about European? I said, oh, fantastic, always have a great meal there. Or what do you think about Flower Drum? And I go, always have a great meal at Flower Drum. It's because you know them, and so like you get extra special attention, you know. So so it's kind of really, you know, I try and get, and that's being unbiased as well. But I guess I think what I don't like is when people come and dine at the restaurant and they go, how was it? And they go, nice. And I go, that's nice. I go, my mum's nice. explain what, you know, just if you don't like it, just tell me, because then I'll, that's constructive criticism that I can go back and go, okay, well, you didn't like that. Why didn't you like it? You know, A, you probably didn't like it because it wasn't your taste, or you didn't like it because it was actually poorly executed. You know, and there are, you know, especially when people come send food back that they say it's too salty. I'll actually, because it's a shared dish, I will taste it to see how salty it is, for example. And if it is too salty if it's too salty that I can't eat it, and I go, it is too salty. But if it's salty because that's my level, like, you know, at the end of the day, the level of salt in the restaurants is dictated by my palate. So if you think it's too salty because purely because you don't cook with enough salt, which is another X factor you've got to compete against when someone dines, you kind of just look and go, okay, cool, no worries. We'll do something to it again, or, you know, always make the customer happy. The customers, you know, always make the customer happy. I'm not saying they're always right, but make them happy.
So what's on the boil here, Adam?
Sorry.
So what's on the boil?
So we've got the boil. We've got some dal here. So a yellow dal here, which has been cooked in some stock with some tomato, some ginger, and some garlic. But what I'm going to do now is just going to temper it again, or temper the. So I've just brought that up to the boil, and this is more of like a loose dal. So most people have like really kind of thick, gluggy, ghee-enriched dal. This is kind of like nice and fresh. How I like it.
Like, we had a beautiful dal last week at the restaurant.
Yes, thank you.
Same one.
So. Soft shell crab pakora. That's another play on, I guess, a pakora. You use a whole soft shell crab. So, just heating the pan up.
How important is humor and good temper in being a chef? And how do you get the most out of it?
Ah.
Like, because everyone has an ego, like, as an artist or a creator.
Yes. Well, some people will say chefs have the biggest egos.
Really?
So, well, I think you need to have a bit of ego, but you need to have some sort of confidence about yourself. But I think you need to have a sense of humour. I think all chefs are quite charismatic and personable. Although, actually, no, I rephrase that, because there are some chefs there who can be a great chef, but they just can't, they don't come across on television or in person, or they're socially, so I'll rephrase that, actually, most, 50% of chefs are socially inept. And even really good ones, they're just kind of like, because they're not, they've been used to just like looking at a wall and pot and stuff, they just don't know how to communicate. So, as you might know, so, you know, that's why a lot of the time chefs won't come out to the customer and say hello to you, because they're just shy and they don't know how to, like, go, hi, how are you going, you know. So, anyway, mustard seeds. I love a mustard seed. Some of my favourite restaurants in Melbourne. I think I just mentioned them all before. European, Cumulus I like, Flower Drum. I don't know what I'm breaking it up for, but put the whole ones in as well. I actually like Rockpool. I think Rockpool's good for like a, you know, steak and just order a steak and lots of their sides. Pacific House in Richmond is one of my favourite. Also, does everyone like, yeah, Pacific House? I love Pho. You can pour it. You're supposed to bring up this with a little sizzle a bit more. You can pour it in. And it's not going to splatter. There you go. Okay. So we just added to all these beautiful aromats.
After mustard seed and before the curry leaves.
Kashmiri chili. So this is a Kashmiri chili here, which is a dried chili. And so the dried chili obviously giving more of the back of the palate, you know, dried chili warm the back of the throat. We've got some asafoetida, my little Malcolm X makes everything taste good. I call it like the MSG of...
We may need crowd control to keep people from storming the kitchen, I think, Adam.
Hopefully.
Everyone's getting very hungry.
Hopefully. Does it smell good? Smell nice?
And Adam, whilst that's tempering and you're preparing that, can you tell us a little bit about chef's hats and how all of that works?
Well, chef's hats. Well, how the chef hat works, and we're just fortunate, very fortunate that Coda and Tonka retained both their chef's hat last week at the Age Good Food Guide Awards. So Coda's always had a chef's hat since we first opened, and Tonka's retained their chef's hat as well. So I guess what they work, you know, I guess talking about chef's hats, Coda and Tonka being one each. That's where I like to place myself in the market. I think one hat restaurants are the most successful ones. They're the busiest ones when you think about it. You know, once you go to two hats or three hats, become an occasional restaurant, and then all of a sudden, you know, not saying that the level of service drops, but I think, like, you know, in a two hat restaurant, it becomes, you know, go there for a wedding anniversary or a special birthday. And there's only so many wedding anniversaries and birthdays people can have in their life. Do you know what I mean? To keep it going. And that's what. So being one hat, being accessible with the food. So, you know, people do eat at my restaurant and all the other restaurants, you know, four times a week. There's less expectation, you know. Not saying that we don't give good food and good service, but I just think it's funny how the psyche works. You know, you read the Gage, does anyone read the Gage Good Food Guide? And you look at a restaurant and go, they got 13, oh, they got 14. It's like, they're still a good restaurant. It's just because this mentality of, like, you know, and you won't go there just because you go, oh, no, I only go to the 14 and a halves or 15s. And it's true, but you got to give these, you know, those, they got reviewed on a one-off, or not one-off, but on a variety of times. And you still got to give them a benefit of the doubt, I think, anyway. That's me just being a chef, restaurateur, owner.
Do they come in as reviewers or do they come in incognito?
Well, a lot of them are incognito. As when you're in the industry for quite a while, you get to know who they are. And I've got their phone number, and kind of like they'll call you or you call them and go, if they came for dinner, or you know, when they come in for the dinner, you go and say hello to them. And that's where you go, hi, how are you going? La, la, la. You don't ask them how the meal's going. You just go, how are you going? You just talk about, you know, talk about golf or who's playing football, or just talk about stuff in general. They'll ask you, but they also want to be, a lot of them want to be known. They want you to recognise them. If you don't, you know, stand up and, you know, oh, how you going, kind of thing, they'll kind of like, well, don't you know who I am? They've got ego as well, and kind of like is. But they're also quite lovely, and they get it. You know, once you talk to them and you kind of tell them your story and stuff, they kind of get it. They know how hard it is. You know, there's some people out there that are a bit irrational. You know. Like when Flower Drum got 10 out of 20, I think that was a bit harsh in the Herald Sun. Did anyone see that? The guy never been a Flower Drum before, but, you know. I think there's two sides to a story, but obviously everyone deserves a fair go. And then sometimes there's no point being reviewed. Sometimes you don't want to be reviewed. I remember back when we first opened Coda. Does anyone remember Stephen Downs? So we actually banned him from Coda, from coming to Coda, because... And then he tried to ban me from the Herald Sun. And I was like, that's not going to work. Well, kind of like, because previous restaurants that I worked at banned him, and then he actually rang me to ask for permission to come and review. And I said, look, Stephen, we're getting good reviews already from the Age and all that. We just opened the business. We've got debt against it. We need to make money. Just don't want any bad karma or anything bad, you know. Oh, just come on, you know. I said, look, you're happy to dine. I'm more than happy for you to dine with me. I explained to you what we're doing, because I knew he wouldn't get it, because we didn't have tablecloths and all this kind of stuff. And, yeah, it just was like, oh, you'll never be in the Herald Sun again. I was like, all right, sure. But that was, you know, there's things you kind of like, you know, that was an unfortunate circumstance, but I knew that it would have been more detrimental to the business, because he would always play off the Age, you know. So... Anyway, a bit of insight of what can go on, the politics of food reviewers. But now, as I said before, everyone's a food reviewer. You know, you go on to Zomato or all that, you know, TripAdvisor and all that, and everyone's got an opinion, which is fine, fair enough. Everyone's got an opinion, but sometimes you can keep it to themselves. Well, if you have got nothing to say. Anyway.
What's cooking, Adam?
What's cooking? So this has got lamb curry, which is a lamb neck curry. So we're using the lamb neck fillet, which I find is the best part of the lamb to use. And now that we use it quite a bit, the price keeps on going up and up. because back in the day, this was a secondary cut of the lamb. You know, you couldn't give it away. And it's got a beautiful, nice, I guess, little chunks of meat without being too fatty and sinewy. So we marinate this in yogurt overnight and ginger and garlic paste. So obviously using all our chicken and fish and lamb, we marinate overnight, so it tenderizes it through the yogurt. And then what we do is we make a curry paste using, I've just got all the ingredients here. Open it. So this is like fresh coconut, freshly grated coconut is base of the curry paste. So we toast that with some white poppy seeds here, coriander seeds, and we've got some black cardamom here, some black cumin, clove, star anise, and we toast that all together, and then we caramelize it with some onion. Do you want to cut some onion? Who's going to cut some onion and caramelize it? I was probably a bit late, but I just want to see your onion skills, onion chopping skills.
Do you want to cut the onions?
All right. All right, no, 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 it's all right. No, sorry. That way. Oh, do you want to cut? Yeah, cut.
This way.
Yeah, that way.
And then.
Yeah, that's way. It. No, the other way. Yeah, that way. So anyway, yeah. So I'll show you. So the reason why they call it chef knives is because theoretically, when you use a knife, you should always have the tip touching the chopping board, because you use the momentum of the knife to slice. And everyone goes, "Oh my God, that's amazing how you cut that onion." And I go, "If you did it for 20 years, you'd be pretty good at it as well." So practice makes perfect. Does anyone know how to stop crime when you're cutting onions? Don't cut them. Stop breathing. And also,
if you wear contact lenses, your eyes don't.
Yeah, if you want to put contact, spend time putting contact. Yeah, correct. If you got to wear contact lenses, oh, that's why you want to cut your onion. Or soak it in water, or wash it in water, wash them under water. That's one of the first things I learned when I was making pizza. I used to have to cut a bag of onions every Friday night when I just started in the pizza shop, and it was really painful. And then he showed me after the first couple of weeks how to do it. Anyway, but also onions also, you know, in cooking, if you'd like to use onion in cooking, but for salads, the spring onion or red onion, is that if you like the flavour and don't like the pungency of onion, soak it in water. We do that in a lot of Japanese cuisine also, venturing out, but that would be quite good. That's a different alternative for your salads. So then we'll blend all our, we'll caramelise our onions, which I'm kind of like, we can do this anyway. You can caramelise. Well, when I burn something, I normally say it's caramelised. So I'm going to take that out. And then we'll have our garlic. So that'll be the base. So this is a paste made separately, and then cooked, put together with the meat. So then we would brown our lamb that's been marinated. We would toast, caramelize the onions off. We'd add all our coconuts that's been toasted, and all our spices that have been toasted as well. And then we put in a wet grinder that we've got, which is like pretty much a big mortar and pestle at the restaurant. And then we make a beautiful, nice, brown, smooth paste. And then we mix the two together, the lamb and the paste and some stock, and just cook it for about 4 hours and then let it set. So it always, you know, our curries are also, our lamb curry is always cooked a day ahead of time. As you know, you need to make it, it's always going to taste better the next day. So that's one of our ways of cooking our curry. We don't really do just like the spice, because we make a paste because of the volume we do, but also I think I like making paste because it gives more texture to the viscosity to the curry. So it's smoother and got more of a sauce, rather than just being straight meat into spices and stock. So
what about modifications? If I came into your restaurant and said I want gravy with no garlic. With no garlic or with the gravy, but I want
tofu. We couldn't give it to you. Because it's kind of like cooked in it. Yeah, pre-made. As much as, that's what I said the day before. So the flavours penetrate the meat. But we do like a really good vegetarian curry.
How do you go with all the dietary requirements and restrictions that people have these days, Adam? Is there so
many? Everyone's a celiac, not by diet choice. It's true. I've never seen so many celiacs in my life. No offense to anyone that is a true celiac, because true celiacs know what they can eat, where other celiacs that are just like a fad, they have no idea. When you go back to them and say, "Can you have soy sauce?" and they go, "Yes, I can." It's like, "No, you can't. You need tamari and all that kind of thing." You know, it's just you accommodate as much as possible. And our waiters, we have a chart. I'm gonna take it off. We have a chart in the back of the kitchen with all the dietary. So we have the dish listed, and then is it celiac friendly? Yes. Is it fructose friendly? Does it have peanuts in? Does it have nuts in it? All these things. So then they use it as a point of reference. We also do double check. The waiters come and double check with us just to make sure, especially with nut allergies. But that's why also in the cooking that nuts are only used, like cooked separately in oil. So we boil our nuts and fry them just and kept into just like as a garnish. They're not an integral part of the dish because it's too hard. As soon as like someone comes in with an anaphylactic peanut allergy, it's like, oh my God. Because I have fed someone nuts before about a few years ago, and it was frightening actually. And it was me and my business partner who runs the front of house, and we both forgot about it because we just said we're busy. It was like, 'cause I got nuts in it? Nah, because we didn't state it on the menu. So that's why now on every dish that has nuts on it in the restaurant, we state if there's nuts on it. So there's already one barrier that the person with a nut allergy can go, no nuts. So things what happens. But yeah. So it is what it is. I think it's at the end of the customer wants to come to your restaurant, and you accommodate as much as possible and try to give them the true experience of what the dishes are. You know, if they, you know, chili is probably the hardest one to accommodate for a tonka, because everything's got chili in it to an extent, or some sort of form of chili. You know, and then the coriander allergies. People have coriander allergies. Apparently. I won't say anything more about the coriander allergy.
it's a thing. If you can't eat coriander, it tastes like soap.
Yeah, I believe you. But I'm saying, like, so, but they can eat. They don't. Anyway.
No, it's not an allergy.
No, it's a dislike. So you know, the
curry you make, would that paste more vegetarian dish
can
you make?
Oh yeah, you can use the paste for the vegetarian, definitely. Yep.
So what sort of vegetarian
thing? Oh, what type of vegetarian? Well, I would cook the sauce out completely and use veg stock to cook it out. And then you can put anything into it. You can put pumpkin into it, any type of vegetable in it. Anyway, I would use a root vegetable, like a sweet potato, to make it kind of to absorb. I would cook the potatoes in the curry sauce as well. So, but it's a totally different, yeah, so that's... be a really nice, rich kind of sauce and hearty sauce as well.
We have time for maybe one or two more questions from the audience. Speak up.
What is it that makes curry actually taste well? Is that the first thing in curry that makes it taste better the next day? And if you don't do it the day before, what's the
Oh, you can do it that day. It's like with anything, like a braise or a stew. The flavours develop and it penetrates the meat. Like, so it intensifies, you know. So I think to make a good curry taste good in the first place, it needs to taste like it the next day. It needs to taste good in the first. It needs to be made well, you know. And you know, always salt. I use a lot of salt in my cooking. You know, cooking throughout the process as well. But you know, it always tastes better. It's always the whole process of, I guess, the marinating process. And I think with all meats and fish, it's all about the marinade. You know, it's all about using spices, dry rubs and wet rubs. That's what makes all food taste really good. You know, and herbs and spices, the cornerstone, I think.
Question down the front here.
How was your first experience using tandoor?
Oh, I'm not very good at it. I've got the asbestos hand for it, but I'm just. Get in the naan. It's hard. Yeah, the rest of the meat's fine, but the naans are hardest. You know, I can make a good pizza, but
your hair on you.
Huh? No, it's not too bad.
And one more at the front.
May I ask you, how do you mix the different spice in order to make a good curry? A student from Sri Lanka make very good curry, and then she left behind different spices, and I did not know how to mix them.
I will write a Tonka cookbook. I think she probably would have used them all in moderation. We should have put them all together, really. But all like, if they would have been all like, yeah, she would have tempered them all together. So the only thing is, it's got to be, as I said, I prefer my spices more ground rather than whole in the curry. So you can grind them all up and make a spice mixture and use them like that. Would be my advice. Blend them all together. Grind them all together.
I love curry.
And then put them in.
So, ladies and gentlemen, if we can thank our volunteers, first of all.
Thank you. You can drop some Nutella cheesecake off to the restaurant.
And Adam, it's been a delight to have you with us tonight at the Australia India Institute Seminar for Health, Culture and Spirituality. We'd like to thank you. A small gift.
Oh, thank you.
And I'm sure everyone will be racing out now towards Tonka, so you better tell your staff.
Yes.
And I'll stay here now.
Okay, exactly. Thank you. Thank you very much.